tough. These things are brutal, man. Let me tell you. Anyways, now we got that figured out. This is the IndyBallJobs podcast. My name is Tyler Blom. I'm going to be your host of this podcast. I am currently a catcher in the Atlantic League for the High Point Rockers. I am on my third year of professional baseball. I graduated from a Division II college. I went undrafted, and I wasn't done playing baseball. Independent baseball is the way I went, and IndyBallJobs is what gave me that opportunity. And IndyBallJobs is also giving me the opportunity to start this podcast and bring on, so many different players and so many different of our alumni and allow them to share their experience with y'all. Here on this podcast, I want to have the founder, Bert Gonzalez, and then the co-owner, Anthony Cromato, tell us a little bit about the journeys to bring us to this opportunity, and also be a really good introduction to like what IndyBallJobs is and a good what independent baseball is. So here it is. I hope y'all enjoy it.
Don't.
All right. What is independent baseball?
You ever been so happy before in your life, like the peak happiness? Think of a time, like think of the best time of your life where you were just so completely happy and nothing can touch you.
Indie ball.
Okay. No, well, now take your shit in your pants. That's indie ball. Speaking from experience.
Oh, man. Speaking of experience.
You know, I always say with indie ball, if you stay in it long enough, you can write a book. I mean, everything is a story, and it's a tremendous story, and... You know, people want to hear about it.
For sure. You know, I mean, yeah.
And it's definitely a lifestyle. It's a different kind of lifestyle. And I think you guys said it earlier. I mean, you have to love it. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. I mean, if you're an indie ball to make some money, you are in the wrong business.
Yeah, this is definitely not a money business. I mean, during the offseason, I'm working at Played Against Sport, selling baseball bats, trying to make a little bit extra money to continue to go play baseball. I mean, earlier we talked about experience, and some of the experience that we have in independent baseball, like the big leaguers that are playing in independent baseball right now, is insane. Like, people overlook the talent of independent baseball.
Absolutely.
I mean, they have no idea that their guy's throwing 98, 99, 100 miles per hour, blowing it past people here. I mean, yeah, with 10 years big league experience, we've had World Series winners on some of our teams. Yeah.
You know, I think about, too, there's a lot of people, you know, going back to what we were previously saying, you know, independent ball, like what it's a pride thing, right? We're so proud to be in indie ball because it is a grind, and it is for thick-skinned people, and it's not for the weak. But if you think about it, my personal experience, people always, you know, when I left a sales career and jumped back into professional baseball, I can't tell you how many people thought I was fucking crazy. But you go through a season, and people could tell, you know, what kind of impact – it has on you. And people are saying, you know, now it's like the number one thing everybody says to me, and I don't want to make this about myself, but everybody's like, you're doing what you love. That's what we love, is we love that grind, and we love being at the field every day. Like, there's nothing better than going to the yard for 8 to 10 to 12 hours a day. There's nothing better.
That's why we always preach. I mean, it's part of it. You know what I mean? And we love that. We love that grind. And it's all just part of it. It's just part of the process. And
also, one of the things, it's not an instant gratification thing. You don't just sign up for pro baseball and you're right away making millions of dollars. You have to grind to get to a point just to make a living, not even $20,000.
We're not really making a living.
That's the thing. Yeah, we're not even making a living. We got to grind to make it through, to get by. I mean, it's a grind in this, like, granted, some people come from contracts of 20-some million dollars from Japan in this league, and they're doing just fine.
But you know what? It's still a grind for them. They got to ride the bus just like we do.
I mean, 13-hour bus trips, 24-hour bus trips with the American Association. I mean, overnight, just on a bus, you finish a game, you go take a shower, you pack the bus up. It's 1 o'clock in the morning, and you got 13 hours to go to New York.
I mean, however, let's talk about the bus rides. I mean, that is where I get the best sleep of my life.
I am looking forward
to these 12-hour bus rides, because that is 12 hours of just sweet dreams that I'm having.
Well, I was going to say, it's either you fall asleep for 12 hours and, you know, you fall asleep, you're in Charleston, West Virginia, and you wake up, you're in Long Island, New York. You're like, oh, that was a crazy sleep.
Oh my gosh. Yeah,
I can't be climbing over people. And on top of that, it disrupts my sleep. So
you get in the bathroom and you just try to take a pee, and you're just rocking back and forth, hitting wall to wall, trying not to pee everywhere.
Everybody sets in, and now you can't pee, and you're like, "Fuck, I'm gonna be here forever."
And then I'm getting so excited for these bus rides coming up. I mean, I just can't wait for it. You know, oh my god,
it is one of the things that makes
somebody's toes cramped up your ass,
man. That's a part of the. That's a part of indie ball. That's a part of baseball. That's a part of the, like, what you remember.
It's part of it.
That's what I talk about a lot. I talk about bus rides so much. I talk about bus rides more than I talk about playing baseball sometimes.
You know, it was one of the, that was one of the things when I when I first got out of baseball in 2012. People would always ask me, like, do I miss it? And I was like, I would think about playing. I'd be like, yeah, I miss competing, like I do. But you could ask any athlete across all sports once they retire, once they step away, the number one thing that they always say, and the thing that I missed the most, was just, it was the locker room and the clubhouse and those bus rides. That camaraderie is just, it's unmatched. You can't get any better than that. It's, there's nothing better than that, in my opinion.
That's the inside part. That's off the field. That's where you kind of develop as a team, because if you have good bus rides and good locker room, that's where some of the best teams, I mean, you would know.
It's all about the great winning environments.
I mean, good chemistry is a good team, and you win championships.
A lot of those bus rides are where teams come together, too.
Yeah. I mean, I remember back in college, there were sometimes bus rides. People were fighting each other, and we were terrible in college. But then you have a team that comes together, and, you know.
You remember in 2020, my managerial debut? See ya. Hometown, Rockland County.
Only dude I know that gets a manager job in professional baseball in his hometown and looks at me and goes, I'm getting thrown out tonight. And then proceeds to get thrown out. His managerial debut in professional baseball gets the gate. See ya.
This doesn't give you an idea of what independent baseball actually is. These guys were really good at baseball and still are really good at baseball. This guy got a hit last year.
Allegedly. The hit was legit. We were allegedly good at baseball.
And we were there. Batting 6 years before, he hits a double, comes off the bench.
So, wild moment. So, I signed a contract in the bar that we're sitting at. My manager, Billy, sent it over, and he's like, you got to sign this. You're active tonight. We're short guys. So I said, yeah, no problem. So, I don't think I'm actually going to see the field, because it happened to me when I signed with Rockland in 19. High Point in 19. And I was like, no way. Like, there's no situation that could possibly mean I'm playing at any time this season when I got signed a contract. I'm on the field, and, Billy looks at me and goes, you're hitting next inning. I said, what? He goes, we're screwed here. You got to hit. I said, all right, cool. So we get through the inning, and guys are going, what's your plan? I said, I'm not going to be up there long. I said, probably three pitches. And again, haven't had a bat in a while. You know, taking BP here and there, but, you know, for me, hitting was always the one thing that I can do, and I work so hard at that. Like, it's just, it's part of you. You know, it's ingrained in you. It's muscle memory. It's whatever. And I remember getting up there and facing Neil Scali. Sorry, Neil. Neil throws a first pitch fastball. I followed off. And then I said, oh, fuck, I hope he throws another one of those, because if he throws me anything else, I'm not coming close to it. And he grooved another two-seamer and, pieced it up for a double in the left center field gap. And on top of that, to make it even cooler, when I got into the dugout, I was kind of just like, you know, trying to get, you know, situated. And Billy goes, hey, look over there. And he points over to the Rockers dugout. And I look over, and there's Jamie Keefe, Frank Viola, and Albert Gonzalez tipping their cap to me. I'm getting a little choked up thinking about it. To get that respect from three of the guys that probably, I couldn't tell you the amount of respect I have for them, to get that respect. I had to go up the tunnel a little bit and collect myself and come back down, and then went back to coaching first base, and that was it. That was my time in the sun, and for sure one of the coolest moments I've ever had. That's fucking independent baseball.
That is indie ball right there.
Coming off
that is indie ball, and witnessing that was freaking awesome, man.
And
that was awesome.
How long did it take for you to get that hit to be on the field in front of all those like ex-big leaguers?
My whole career, it took me to get that one at bat in the Atlantic League when I played and when I was coming up and when I was a kid in high school, college, and pro. You couldn't sniff this league unless you had some pedigree to you. You had to have time in the big leagues. You had a time in Double A. You had to have been a dude. You couldn't go near this league. This wasn't a league where I could go and play out of the spaghetti league in Italy. You know what I mean? So it took me 20 years to get that hit, and to be able to go get that first hit on my first at bat is literally a dream come true. Literally.
Yeah, I mean.
You had a much greater success than I did my first Atlantic League at-bat.
Oh, my God. I was so fired up for your at-bat. I was so fired up.
I got the good morning, good afternoon, good night, see you later, three pitches.
Yeah, well, guess what?
You're gone.
Well, listen, I mean, there was that. That's one at-bat. I could tell you about the rest of the at-bats I had that season. I don't really want to.
I do remember the second I saw you make contact, the first thing I said out loud is, no way.
I think that was everybody's reaction.
Everybody, no way. That ball was flying.
The only one I just knew if he threw that two-seamer, he was going to do something stupid.
But yeah, it's like, I think that was everybody's reaction. Like MC, our trainer, was filming the on her phone. And I think it might have been Angel Garcia. It was somebody in the background when I hit it. The response was just, no fucking way. So, you know, but that was cool too. You know, I talked about the respect that I got from the Rockers, but also from the boys that were in Charleston. You know, there was a lot of respect given. And that's, again, go back to what I was saying previously, that's what mattered. And, you know, for me to be able to work with those hitters every day, you know, and just kind of be with them and hang out with them, I'm learning more about hitting than, you know, than they might think, just because, you know, there's a lot of high level baseball players, a lot of high level hitters, but for those guys, you know, we had big leaguers on a team.
Yeah, we had a World Series winner.
Yeah, and, you know, to get respect from him was great. And you know, Nick Longhi was, I think, I think happier than I was. It gives me chills thinking about it. I get choked up thinking about it, talking about it. It's just one of those experiences that, if not for Indy Ball, that just never happens. Never ever happens.
True. And you know, just going back to the talent level that you can find here in Indy Ball, you know, I grew up in an area where Indy Ball is kind of dominant up in the Northeast, and growing up, and it's family affordable, and there were always some big names going through these Indy Ball teams. I would always go to the New Jersey Jackals games, the Long Island Ducks, and you know, they're always marketing somehow of this big leaguer coming into town. And as a kid, you know, you go to the game and they're so close to you. You know, it's like the closest you can get to these big names. And it was cool. And just knowing that growing up, you know, and then being in it now, you still see those kind of big names. And that's kind of what draws a lot of people, you know.
And a lot of people also don't even see that part of the game. Like, a lot of people miss how many big names actually come play in this game. Like, you got to see it up close. But, like, people in my area have no idea what independent baseball is. And I'm, like, trying to explain it to them. Like, there's real talent. Like, I'm really facing dudes throwing fuzz that were in the MLB. Like,
exactly. And if you're not from these areas, these small towns where indie ball exists, you're not going to know. There's, like, a lack of knowledge to indie ball a little bit. And I hope with this podcast, you know, I hope we can just bring some knowledge some of these, you know, towns that don't have indie ball. And if you're on vacation somewhere and you're by, you know, the ballpark, and you know, come by the ballpark. If you're ever bored, you'll be surprised.
It's affordable, that's for sure. Yeah,
you can watch it literally any game on YouTube. It'll be on six days a week on YouTube. Just type in sure. any game.
And just think about it, as a kid, if you were to go to a different ballpark when you were on vacation and you enjoyed it, you'd be a fan of them, right?
Yeah,
and
you have access. That ball or whatever,
yeah, you have access now to being able to watch it on YouTube wherever you are in the country. So Blum, why don't you tell me what is this podcast about? I mean, you are the host. You are the host of this podcast.
I really want to kind of bring, like, an idea to the game of independent baseball, because kind of like what I was saying earlier, in my area, people don't know what it is. I mean, no one knows what the Atlantic League is or what the Frontier League is, because there's no teams in the Virginia area that's independent baseball besides, like, Maryland. That's an hour, two-hour trip. I just kind of want to bring attention to, like, really what the talent in the game is, like, how good players are, and, like, kind of the respect of being in these leagues. Like, the Frontier League, man, I mean, people are like, oh, that's, like, an independent league. Like, it doesn't mean anything. No, I mean, there's people that – kids were drafted out of high school for millions of dollars. I mean, there's veterans playing that league. The Atlantic League, you got a bunch of, like, MLB.
We got a bunch of MLB players and two slapdicks to your left and right.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, I'm fortunate enough. Like, I graduated from a Division II college 3 years ago, and I'm fortunate enough to play on the same field as people who have 5+ years of big league experience. I mean, guys have been playing baseball in professional baseball since I was in middle school. Like, I watched some of these guys, these are grown men, play on TV. I've played as them in a video game, and now I'm, hey man, like, sharing a locker room with them. Like, it's crazy what the opportunities independent baseball can bring, and I want to allow people to see that. And I also want to bring the inside of it. I mean, this has been the most fun playing baseball I've ever had. I mean, I'm so relaxed. Like, I do understand, like, I have to, like, grind, I have to perform, I have to do well, so, like, that's always in the back of my mind. but it's easy because of this environment. It's like you do what you have to do to perform. Like you're not on a set routine. You're not having to hit backside only because the guy in the lineup, like in college, like you hitting like a routine, like your coach is, hey, you're all hitting backside this round. You're all doing this, but some routines don't work for other people. You can be individual here and you're like your own, you're your own business. You're your own like entrepreneur. Like I am
trying to look at it.
Like I'm trying to promote myself. Wow, you, like
wow. Pretty smart.
Our baby growing up.
Wow. Man, just thinking of different things.
Oh, by the way, the guys in this league are kids. If you're fucking 158 years old, like I am.
Yeah. And that's the thing. Like you also run into it. Like I was playing like the catcher who I got to play with last year, Yovan Gonzalez. I mean, one of the best dudes I've run into playing baseball.
The caballo.
And he was 10 years older than me. Sorry, Yovi. I didn't mean to call you old on this thing, man.
Jesus Christ.
He was 10 years older than me and he taught me so much. And if it wasn't, if I was in single A, I wouldn't have had the opportunity to be around him. I wouldn't have got to learn what he's gotten to learn as quickly as I would have. I mean, I feel like I know a whole lot more now into baseball just from being in the locker room last year in Charleston. I mean, like I keep saying, we had a World Series winner, Juan Carlos Perez. I mean, with the Giants, the dude knows so much about baseball. He would just tell me how simple it has to be. And like, I'm grateful that independent baseball allowed me to be around those guys. And I kind of want everyone else to know, like, hey, if you don't get drafted, like, don't cut out professional baseball. Like, independent ball is a great route to take. I mean, the Frontier League, the Pioneer League, the American Association, Atlantic League, they're all partnered with the MLBs. Like, there's scouts there every single day looking to pick people up. I mean, there's guys rotating through. Like, if you think, oh, maybe I'm not good enough right now, go play a couple years in an Atlantic League or figure out, hey, am I good enough? Because I found out, like, I can hit against really good pitching.
Hey, you're definitely good enough.
I don't want to, I mean,
you're here.
I still have to prove and perform that and stay here. It's not like it's just given to me and all. I mean, there's a lot of work that comes with it, but I've learned how to get better. I've learned how to put that work in, like listening to these guys off season and their routines. And I want to share, like bring those guys on the podcast and help teach young guys in the game and give them like some inside information that I've gotten. Because being at home, I've talked with some like double A, single A guys, and listen to them talk. It's not the same as hearing a big leaguer or triple A or like 10-year experience guy talk. It's
even just a guy with indie ball experience that's been around.
Yeah, I mean, there's guys with 13 years in independent ball that's giving me some of the best information, and they're just indie ball only, no affiliated, and they're making it work. They grind, they have their jobs, they know their routine, they know what to do. And they show you the way that, hey, man, this is what you need to do to make it work.
Yeah, I think you you're putting eyeballs on independent baseball, which I think is extremely important. It's important for independent baseball. It's important for, you know, players out there to know that there's a different route. There's a lot of uneducated baseball players when it comes to independent baseball. I didn't really know much about independent baseball when I got out of Italy. I tried to catch on in independent baseball, but I never had indie ball jobs when I was coming out of Italy. So, and I really didn't know how to get an indie ball. I didn't really know what indie ball was all about. I didn't know anything. So for you to start this podcast and educate those whether it's players, parents, whoever out there. So it's pretty good.
The thing is, like for me, I'm not going to lie. I was very discouraged after like college, after I didn't get like drafted or get any phone calls to go play affiliated. And I didn't take the right steps, but for my dad, because you mentioned parents, my dad found your post on Facebook and got in touch with you. And if it wasn't for my dad, man, I mean, he really reached out and that gave me an opportunity. He put me in front of IndyBall Jobs. And I kind of want to get to that, what IndyBall Jobs is and what y'all have done for me and kind of what you guys have brought into independent baseball. Because like it's a huge impact into it. I mean, you are giving opportunity that I never thought was possible. I mean, I was dreaming, I mean, praying for this opportunity. Hey, man, I just want to get in front of the right people. And then if it wasn't for, like, my dad being a parent, searching around, just wanting to help out for the best, or, like, my buddy, I mean, he came across it and asked me, hey, I saw IndyBall Jobs. I was just going through Instagram, asked me questions. We're just out there for people to find the information. I mean, you guys give the opportunity to help get into independent baseball rather than just going to, like, the tryouts or the showcases. And when most teams are already made, like, if you go to a tryout, and you do well, but there's not a spot for you, you're probably forgotten about. Like with y'all with Indie Ball Jobs, you guys stay in touch with the people and you make phone calls nonstop. Hey, I just got released. Well, guess what? You're going to make a phone call to help me get somewhere else because you believe in me and you give that out with Indie Ball Jobs and you've given that opportunity to a bunch of people. And so I kind of want to open that to y'all now. Like, what is Indie Ball Jobs?
Well, Indie Ball Jobs, you know, it was just it was an idea and a vision that that I had that was an inspiration to a player that I pretty much found at a pro day. His name is Frank Nigro, and he's currently he just started out in Double A with the Minnesota Twins, and big shout out to Frank Nigro, finishing the season last year in Triple A. But anyways, you know, I saw him at a pro day, at a Division II only pro day, and you know, he was just different to me. In my eyes, he was different, and there was a scout there for every single major league organization. At this time, I was transitioning from the Rockland Boulders to the High Point Rockers, and I just went there just to check it out. And there was this kid, just one time catch and throw, and I said, oh my goodness, that is a Double A catcher. I mean, right now, and that's definitely a big league catcher. And you know, that was it. You know, I didn't speak to him or anything. They asked him to throw again a few times, the scouts, so I figured, you know, this kid's definitely gonna get drafted. At the time I was coaching at Felician University, so shout out to them. And they were in the same conference, where Frank Nigro was playing. And, my last game with Felician, we were actually playing against Frank, and, I got to watch him catch. And once again, it was just a thing of beauty. And, I figured, you know, good for this kid. He's going to get drafted, and I'll try and remember his name and see where he goes. You know, fast forward months later, going into the High Point Rocker season in 19, We lose one of our catchers. He gets picked up to go to Double A, and you know, we're on the bus and we're in panic mode. We're going to York, Pennsylvania, and we don't have a catcher, and we needed a guy immediately, and we couldn't find anybody. And I took a leap of faith, and this is the first player I ever recommended that I truly believed in, that I saw. And you know, I was shy, and I was a rookie in the Atlantic League, and I'm just a bullpen catcher. Yeah. You know, at the end of the day, I'm just a bullpen catcher. So I just lean over to Skip, and I'm like, hey, I did see this catcher at a showcase, and pretty sure he got drafted, but if he didn't, I mean, why not? Oh. If we just need him for the weekend. He's like, make your phone calls. So I make my phone calls, and lo and behold, he did not get drafted, which is crazy to me. And he was driving up to Michigan to go to a USPBL tryout.
Shout out to the USPBL.
Yeah, I mean, you guys would have had a good one, but yeah, we kind of stole him from you. So
yeah, sorry.
So right there on the bus, I mean, sorry, we offered him to come for the. It was just for the weekend. You know, we're gonna fly him now that he was on his way to Michigan. We were flying him from Michigan to New York so he could pick up his car to drive to Pennsylvania and to play for the weekend, and that was it. He understood that was gonna be it. And, you know, maybe we'll try and find you a job somewhere else. And, I mean, the kid, he did unbelievable that weekend, and he stuck around the entire season. And, you know, long story short, you know, had a hell of a career his first year in Indie Ball. And he played another year in 2020. And right after that, he got picked up with the Twins, and he's just working his way up the system. And that's the idea. That was the idea. If, you know, if we were able to find Frank Nigro, somebody who almost didn't have an opportunity at all. I mean, who knows if he would have even made that team in the USPBL. If we can find somebody like that, a diamond in the rough like that, you know, just falling through the cracks at the end of the day, just absolutely fell through the cracks. And I figured, why not? You know, I had a few years in Indie Ball. I met the right people. And, you know, Jamie Keefe is my manager, who's well-connected and has been in Indie Ball forever. And, you know, we figured we can put these showcases together and give guys an opportunity, guys like Frank Nigro. And lucky enough, we've been able to find a bunch of you guys. And it's been awesome. It's been awesome to watch you guys and watch you guys have success and live the dream, man. And, you know, we're waiting on that first big leaguer. So Frank Nargo, let's go. I mean, come on, hurry up.
Hey, catching in a big league spring training game.
And shout out to him and us watching. I mean, Blum, you weren't here, but
oh man,
us watching him on TV, in a big league spring training game. I completely forgot about that, actually.
Shout out to Fletch for texting us and letting us know he was in the game.
Oh, man. Yeah, for sure.
How about that dude belongs there? He just looks like he belongs.
Oh, he just if I was just watching a big league game, I would feel like
I wouldn't even know. Oh, that guy's supposed to be there.
Yeah, he got drafted in the second round, probably. Yeah. Who knows? But, yeah, I mean, that's pretty much how it started. And, you know, it's been able to grow and you know, I've been able to add Anthony as a partner, and he's had, you know, a similar story as myself and a story like Frank Nigro, and just, you know, just looking for an opportunity and just not having the right guidance or knowing the right people or the right connections at the end of the day. And you know, we were able to grind through the system here and network and be able to, you know, kind of give back to the next generation at the end of the day. You know, that's what it's all about.
Saying that's what it's all about. I mean, it just sounds like being really good at doing your job. Like you say, he understood his job. He was coming in just for that series. Well, guess what? He did really good at his job and it opened another opportunity for him. I mean, you did really good at your job to open all this opportunity for yourself. I mean, you've done good at your job to get this opportunity to be here. I mean, so kind of at the end of the day, it sounds like just being good
but just
at your job.
Also, just so everybody understands as well, is you have to have the talent.
You have to
be able to play this game.
Yeah, 100%.
You know, I wish I could help everybody, but at the end of the day, you have to have the talent to be able to play at the professional level. I mean, I think this is professional baseball. But there are guys out there that can play, and they just don't have the connections or the right opportunities to get there, and sometimes all somebody needs is an opportunity.
Just that one chance, man. And you can make the most out of literally the smallest thing. That's just it. The smallest opportunity you need it. You got to take it and you run with it.
Yeah, that's it. It used to be you needed to be in the right place at the right time and the right person to see you.
Yeah, exactly.
But now, and a big reason, you know, I want to jump in with Burr is because I looked at it, it's just like, wow, man, if I – you know, you always look at it through your eyes first, I guess. But and I was like, man, if this type of thing was around, who knows? You know, you don't know, but it's just like there at least the possibility for just a little bit of an opportunity is there. So you look at that and you go, we could literally give it back. Like Bert just said, you give it back to a whole new generation of ball players that maybe some guys do fall through the cracks. And now we provide a platform for them to not get missed. You know, if you're good, come to a showcase. All we can do is host that showcase for you.
Yeah. And put the right people there.
And bring the right people, you know, and thankfully through the years and all the hard work that Bert's done and, you know, Jamie Keefe and the rest of our staff, you know, these are great baseball people. They're great people in general. And, you know, they come because they know that they can find a diamond in the rough at one of these things. So if you think you got the talent, come out. You know, all we can do is put you out there and then you showcase. And that goes back to Bert's point. You have to have the talent. You have to be a good dude and you have to have the talent. So, you know.
And we love doing it. I mean, we love going to those showcases. putting it in the showcases together it's a lot of work and it's difficult. But when it comes to event day, I mean, it's awesome. I mean, we go out there as a staff and we rent an Airbnb and we just have a great time. And at the event, we're out there with the boys. Right? I mean, what else do you want to do in February?
Man, it was so much fun.
It's 2 days out in the field with the boys.
Sunshine.
You know what I mean? And you get to meet different people and hear different stories. And, I mean, we enjoy it. We love it. And that's why we're going to continue to do it. I mean, like I said, it's a lot of work to put these events together. But at the end of the day, I mean, what a great 2 days that we have while we're there.
It was a blast. And we got to help a bunch of guys in our Georgia
We're building memories, too, you know?
Yeah. I mean, when y'all gave me the phone call, hey, do you want to come, like, just hang out and come to the showcase? I mean, right away, I wanted to be a part of that. That sounded like a lot of fun.
And then who knew that this kid is good with media stuff?
Yeah. Shout out to my dad again. thank you for this camera and for giving me creative ability. Creative time.
thanks, Mr. Blum.
What a guy.
but yeah, you know, that's those things. Like, and going back to what Bert said, you want to help everybody. You want to help everybody, but you can't. You know, it's just the bottom line. You can't help everybody. And you know what? Also, we really can't control what other teams' needs are either. You know, there's people that show up to those things that they're looking for a specific role player, or they're looking for a catcher. They need two or three arms. You don't know, but you might be able to fit the mold for something. Somebody might see and be like, all right, I could do something with that. I could use a player that could run, or I could use a player that's got a cannon from there, something. Now what happens with those guys that take your name down after that, we don't really have any control over. We wish we could, because I know Bert, I've watched Bert do this for a long time now, and he's never not missed on a player. Like he's devoted to getting guys to a place, and he continues to let anybody who will listen know that, you know, player A, B, and C need to play somewhere this year. They'll help your ball club, just take them. And a lot of times, you know, they get passed up on, and a lot of times they have to wait their turn for later in the season when there's an injury. And a lot of times it doesn't really come of anything. You know, it's just the way professional baseball is, especially in independent ball. But, you know, it's fun when that opportunity comes knocking at the weirdest time.
I mean, we've had guys get signed after coming to their third or fourth event. You know what I mean? You know, we couldn't help them the first few. They got a little better, or you know, they just happened to go to an event where somebody needed that specific position or that specific player. And, you know, persistent, you know. But it comes back to, you have to have the talent. You just do.
Yeah.
You know.
Bottom line.
And I do also kind of want to mention something, like, not only, I mean, these kids are coming back to these showcases, I mean, knowing that you guys care. Like, it's not like, okay, they didn't sign out of the first one, you gave up on them. Like, you kept making phone calls. You keep, like, putting their name out, so they keep showing back. Like, they're...
Yeah.
This is like a family. Like, you become a family with this thing if you do have the talent and, like, you are a good person and you do show well for yourself. I mean, they're going to put themselves everything they can to do on the line. I mean, I've seen very little of the behind the scenes, and it is insane the amount of work that I've seen y'all, like, go through, just listen to what you've talked about, kind of what it takes to set this stuff up. It's not easy, and I just gotta do the easy stuff with it. I mean,
the stuff that you think is easy is incredibly difficult to
for us. Yeah,
yeah. You hooked up a microphone. I thought it was the greatest thing I've ever seen in my life. I was like, holy shit, that goes there. Like, that's great. But like,
you got all these colorful lights.
There's you got to see this switchboard. It looks like I'm in a fucking spaceship back here. But I am, seriously, I'm glad that, and thank you. I know Bird appreciates that. I definitely appreciate that. I'm glad that you said that, because we honestly and genuinely truly do care. We give a shit. You know, I say it at all our events, because I want players to understand that you're sitting in front of a staff of guys that truly and honestly care about you and your career. We want to do the best thing for you. We want to try and give you the best opportunity possible if that opportunity presents itself. We want to make sure that we stay in touch with you as much as we can, even though it's hard during the season, and it's hard leading, you know, toward those tails, the off season tails off into the spring training time. But, you know, there's not a better group of baseball people and people to try to facilitate an opportunity for you to sign somewhere. You know, I always say it, like, you know, there's a handful of people in baseball that actually give a shit about you, and they're all right here. So, you know, and Bert says it all the time, we're in the line of fire with you. We are you. We're you. We've been there. Bert and I have been there. Bert, I mean, you know, you come out of Spain, you turn around, nobody got your back, right?
I was out of professional baseball immediately.
Yeah, so you know, there was nobody being like, hey, I got a guy. You know, all the people that you know and all the people that you played for and played with, nobody was knocking on your door saying, hey, buddy, I got you an opportunity. That's where I think Bert, you know, does such a great job in making sure that we do our damnedest to make sure that we do everything the right way, or try to do everything the right way, and give, you know, exhaust every resource we have to make sure that we could get the guys that deserve an opportunity that aren't getting a shake.
And I mean, you do a damn good job at it, man. Let me tell you what, I'm super grateful for y'all making the phone calls y'all did to give me the opportunity that I got, man. I mean, cannot thank you guys enough for that.
Yeah,
appreciate it.
You know, it's persistency, right? So we do have Indie Ball Jobs merch. If you follow our Instagram, you've probably seen our staff wearing the short sleeve hoodies, which can be purchased, and this is what you're looking for. I don't like standing up. I feel like a jerk off.
That's all right, man.
We have our short sleeve hoodies and our Richardson trucker hats, the best hat in the business. if you are interested, reach out to us on Instagram at IndyBallJobs. DM us, let us know if you're interested in a short sleeve hoodie or a trucker hat. And we are definitely going to have more to come for sure in the near future.
And also follow us on Instagram and TikTok at IndyBallJobs to keep updates like with our players, alumni, and keep updates with like the upcoming showcase. We will announce like when we're having showcases and where we're having them at and give you all the information on there.
Until our next event
comes. Yeah, wait. Yeah. So just follow us on Instagram and TikTok at IndyBallJobs, and you can find out whatever you need.